In this lecture, we're going to briefly discuss the neutrino particle. So the neutrino particle is a very, very elusive particle. That is, it's very hard to detect. And as we'll see in this lecture, one of the reasons for that is because it has a very, very small mass. The neutrino also has no charge, and so that means it doesn't feel any type of electric or magnetic force. So let's take a look at the following nuclear reaction, the following interaction that takes place between particles. So we have a neutron that basically decays into a proton and electron in the process, releasing some type of neutrino. Now, the neutrino was first hypothesized to explain the conservation of energy and momentum in the following beta decay reaction. Now, in 1956, the neutrino was actually detected and its existence was confirmed experimentally. And in 1962, it was discovered that the neutrinos come in three different types. So these types are known as flavors. So we have three different flavors for our neutrino. We have the electron neutrino, the muon neutrino, as well as the tau neutrino. So basically, every single lepton contains its own corresponding neutrino. So the electron, the muon, and the tau are three types of leptons, and each one of these leptons contains its own type of neutrino. Now, because the neutrino is so elusive, many problems still exist that deal with neutrinos that still have not been answered. Now, one of the problems that is believed to be resolved is known as the solar neutrino problem. So, if we examine the neutrinos on Earth, where exactly do these neutrinos actually come from? Well, they come from outer space. Specifically, they come from the Sun. Remember, the Sun is a thermonuclear reactor. It basically contains nuclear fusion reactions, nuclear reactions that readily produce electron neutrinos. And these electron neutrinos travel through space and eventually end up on Earth. Now, when scientists actually set out to calculate how much neutrinos end up on any given square centimeter of the Earth, they found that the hypothesized value for the neutrinos that should end up on Earth does not match the actual value, that is, the actual number of neutrinos that reach the Earth is far less than the theoretical amount that should reach the Earth. And the question is, where exactly do these electron neutrinos go? So this problem was a problem that was not answered for a very long time, and eventually it was resolved with the neutrino flavor oscillation. So basically, this is the idea that under certain proper conditions, under certain circumstances, any given one of these neutrinos can basically transform into a different flavor. So we see that our electron neutrino can transform into the tau or the muon neutrino. The muon neutrino can transform into either one of these, and the tau neutrino can also transform into either the muon or the electron neutrino. And this ability for the neutrinos to basically oscillate back and forth between the different types of flavors is known as the neutrino flavor oscillation. Now, the next problem about our neutrino, which still has not been resolved, is the issue with the mass. So what exactly is the mass of our neutrino? So we know the neutrino is very, very small. In fact, initially, it was hypothesized that our mass of the neutrino was zero. However, today, we believe that the upper limit of the sum of all these these three types of neutrinos is given by 0.14 electron volts. This is an extremely small value, and this means that if we take the sum of these three neutrinos, the sum of their masses, the sum cannot exceed 0.14 electron volts. Now, to compare to the mass of something that's also small, let's compare to the mass of our electron. One electron has a mass of 0.511 mega electron volts. So that means the electron has a mass that is much, much greater than the mass of the sum or the sum of the masses of these three neutrinos. So we see that if the neutrino does in fact have a mass, it's very, very small. Now we see that for the neutrino flavor hypothesis to actually be correct, for the neutrinos to be able to oscillate back and forth between the different flavors, the neutrino must have a mass. Now, another problem, another question that still has not been answered is a neutrino part of a category of particles known as the Majorana particle? So, the Majorana particle is basically a particle that can act as its own antiparticle. And two examples of such particles is the photon and the Z boson. So, basically, the photon can act as its own antiparticle, and when two photons combine, they can annihilate one another. So that's exactly what we mean by an antiparticle. So basically, we still do not know if the neutrino is part of this Majorana category. That is our neutrino its own antiparticle? So if the neutrino is in fact a Majorana particle, that means the electron neutrino can act as its own electron antineutrino. The muon neutrino can act as its own muon antineutrino, and the tau neutrino can also act as its own tau antineutrino.